Welcome everybody to this special show only on the vaccine. There are a lot of WhatsApp rumors going around. A lot of people are being provoked to get scared. So in the midst of it, we have two giants, two experts, an infectious disease specialist from Global Hospital and Ilavati Hospital, Dr. Vasant Nagvekar. Dr. Shashank Joshi has been always there. Both of them are part of the task force which is overseeing the entire COVID activity in the state of Maharashtra. And one more introduction. Vasant Nagvekar has actually... Dr. Vasant Nagvekar actually has been a patient who has survived the COVID virus. And with this, I will ask Dr. Shashank to actually introduce Vasant a little more for the audience.
So Dr. Vasant Nagvekar is a world-class infectious disease specialist. He's my batchmate from Grant Medical College, where he did his MBBS and MD in internal medicine. Subsequently, he decided to pursue a career in infectious diseases and is trained in Chennai. And currently, he's at, as Dr. Shetty said, at Global and Ilavati Hospital in Infectious Diseases. He has a keen interest in all types of infectious diseases. And he has been closely involved with transplantation infections. He has been closely involved with antimicrobial stewardship policies. He has been an expert on various expert committees of the Indian Council of Medical Research. He has done some seminal work in HIV, hepatitis, and currently in the last 1 year, he has been actively involved in COVID care, in designing treatment protocols in early treatment, in treatment protocols in delayed treatment, and has been very actively involved in also clinical trial programs related to antiviral drugs and immunological drugs. Vasant, thank you so much for joining us. And I will now ask Dr. Harish Shetty to start his question answer session.
Absolutely. Yeah, this is not an interview, Shashank and Vasant. This is an interrogation. A lot of rumors are going around, and I want you all to be crisp, clear, and shoot answers and clear the doubts in the minds of doctors, lay people, and others. Bullseye. Let me ask you the first question. Two vaccines have been rolled out in India. Are they safe? Vasant first.
Yeah, so I think the presently two vaccines. One is the vector borne, that is the chimpanzee adenovirus vector vaccine, which is the COVID shield, which is rolled out. And the second one is the killed inactivated virus vaccine, that is by Bharat Serum. Both are being rolled out. The first one is almost in the phase 3 trial completed. The second one is also in the phase 3 trial completed, but we are waiting for the publication or the data to be published in the second vaccine, that is the inactivated vaccine by Bharat Serum. Whereas the first vaccine, which is the vector-borne chimpanzee adenovirus vector, we don't have data from India, but I think we have data from across the world, another 6 countries where we have strong data about this vaccine. So I think both of them seem to be fairly safe, but we have to wait for more data from Indian data to come up. And I think that's only possible because of the pandemic. I think we cannot go according to the trials what normally a vaccine goes through. It takes almost, I think, 5 to 7 or sometimes even 10 years. But in this pandemic, we'll have to fast track this and go into the phase 3 trial into the public.
So I think I agree with Dr. Vasant Nagvekar that vaccines, both these vaccines are safe. Both these vaccines have been super fast tracked, but every vaccine in COVID care has been super fast tracked. And as Dr. Vasant said, the first one is based on a chimpanzee adenovector virus platform on which the spike protein has been embedded, while the second one is an inactivated killed virus vaccine. Both these vaccines may be safe. Their efficacy is the one which we need to look at more crucially and critically. But I think the safety standpoint, they have stood the various tests of safety as per the current protocols. And the Indian trial, phase 2, phase 3 clinical trial of Covishield is ongoing. So is the phase 3 trial for the Covaxin. And as Vasant rightfully mentioned, The Lancet published the phase 3 trial of the Covishield which was conducted in United Kingdom, South Africa, Brazil, United States. And that trial is already in public domain. The only challenge with safety is that these both vaccines can cause a little pain on the injection site. It can cause a little fever. It can cause mild symptoms, which are usually self-limiting or can be treated by a simple paracetamol.
Thank you, both of you. And the second question, which is very clear, are they efficacious? Are they as efficacious as the vaccines used in the Western countries? I would not name them.
I think the one which is being used in the Western country, that is United States and UK, United Kingdom, initially, which was, I think that is the mRNA vaccine, which is the Pfizer one and the Moderna vaccine, which is by after giving two doses, that is 3 weeks or 4 weeks apart, has been shown to have an efficacy of almost 90% to 95% or close to that, what has been shown. So I think the efficacy wise, it is good. If you see the influenza vaccine, the efficacy is only anywhere from 50% to 70%. So compared to that, I think after two doses of this, what is being used in United States, the Moderna and the Pfizer vaccine, the efficacy has been around 90% to 95% with two doses of given around, I think, 4 weeks apart, 3 to 4 weeks apart. But the problem with this Moderna with the Pfizer vaccine was that it has to be stored at minus 80 degrees centigrade. And that is a real challenge, especially for a developing country like India, where if it has to be transmitted to rural areas and all that, it's a challenge. The Moderna vaccine is slightly better that it has to be stored at minus 20 degrees centigrade. And so that is slightly better off. But better off the vaccines which are there in India, the one is the Covishield and the Covaxin, which are, you know, you just require 2 to 8 degrees of centigrade, which is very much possible within the Indian limits. So I think efficacy-wise, if you see the Covishield, it has already shown to be efficacious by two doses if taken ideally 4 weeks apart, but you can go up to 12 weeks. And I think in one of the papers, it mentioned up to 28 weeks also where I read. So I think 12 weeks apart, if you take two doses, I think the first dose may be half a dose. That was the trial showed that if you take the first dose as half and the subsequent as the full dose, the efficacy was close to around more than 90%. Similarly, Covaxin also has shown results close to more than 90%. I think so. I would say all the four vaccines are equally efficacious, showing efficacy of more than 90%. For Indian conditions, Indian climatic conditions, Indian rural areas, transport, looking at all that, I think our Indian, that is the Oxford vaccine, that is the Covishield and the Covaxin, which is by the Bharat Serum, seems to be best suited for India. And the efficacy seems to be equally good as the mRNA vaccines which are being used abroad but which are not in presently in India. So I think these are the four vaccines, and then we have a lot of other vaccines to come into the pipeline about the various other platforms which the vaccines are being developed.
Dr. Shashank.
So a couple of things. As Vasan rightfully said, in the Western world, the Moderna and Pfizer have shown 94-95% efficacy. Now, what is this efficacy? Efficacy is that these vaccines are currently not COVID appropriate behavior and masking will continue throughout because it may not prevent a mild or asymptomatic COVID infection, but it will definitely mitigate a severe infection and probably save a life. That is number one. The mRNA platform used needed, particularly the Pfizer one, needs a minus 70 degrees storage. And the protein will get denatured once the storage and the minus 70 comes down. And it mimics some mini COVID-like symptoms. That is the vaccine which has seen maximum allergic reactions, anaphylactic shock, and people get almost mini COVID symptoms. So that is the first two vaccines. But Covishield, which is coming to India, is discovered by the Oxford University group. It has been marketed by AstraZeneca, but is mass manufactured by Serum Institute. And that is based on a safer platform, which is a spike protein embedded to an adenoviral chimpanzee, and that will generate antibodies, while the second one is a killed vaccine. Both of them, the dosing of the Covishield was very hotly debated in the medical literature, because if two doses were given with full doses 28 days apart, then the efficacy was only 62%. If it was given with a gap of 3 months, as Vasant said, the efficacy went up to 80%. And if half dose was given first and then full dose was given second, then the efficacy went up to 90%. So these are unanswered questions. Remember, all vaccines have emergency use authorization. All vaccines are in research mode. And all vaccines all over the world are voluntary. So they are not compulsory. So these three things we should keep in the mind and then take a call. And I personally feel that this vaccine is safe. It has some impact on efficacy based on the current available data. And it appears not to have any serious or deleterious side effects. Sir, you are muted.
If I'm going to ask you a question which is really there on the WhatsApp groups. If the numbers have gone down in India, why do you need a vaccine? If the numbers are really going down, why do you need a vaccine?
To answer that question, my take is if the numbers have gone down in India, it is all the more necessary to take the vaccine, because after 2 to 3 months, you might have the second wave like it happened in UK. But Vasant has domain knowledge in this area. Vasant, your take.
Yeah, I think the naturally what you got COVID, like I got COVID, your antibodies may last to 6 to 8 months, and beyond that it may not last, you know. So I think a vaccine developing antibodies, that is a T cell and B cell immunity, will be much stronger and long lasting. And I think it will be at least minimum for 1 year, but actually some papers say up to 5 to 6 years. But at least we assume that it will be there with us, these antibodies, for 1 year. And maybe we don't know whether we'll have to take a repeat shot after 2 years. That's a different story. But I think you're naturally getting a COVID, your antibodies in the body will last anywhere from 3 to 6 months. But a vaccine would have much better immunogenic reaction and a better immune system robust developed in the person compared to the natural infection. And so even if you are developing some herd immunity, that may be temporary, and we should not have the second wave as it is going in the Western world. So I think it become very, very important that I think a vaccination should be started as early as possible to have not only cover the healthcare workers, but I think everybody as whatever is possible to develop that herd immunity of 50 to 70%.
Thank you. I think you answered both the questions. The numbers have gone down. You still need a vaccine. And those who have been infected with COVID once also would need a vaccine. Now, the other apprehension is, one of my friends, many of my friends who suffer from rheumatoid arthritis and other diseases, especially autoimmune diseases, are very tense to take this vaccine, because they said that there was no data which showed any utility, or there was no data showing experimental use or research use in any study with populations who have had autoimmune diseases, rheumatoid arthritis, and other similar illnesses.
So I think as far as the efficacy of, I think the safety wise, I don't see neither the Oxford or the, that is Covishield or the Covaxin. Covaxin is a completely inactivated killed vaccine. So I think that would be the meaning very much safer. As well as Oxford, I think it is the vector borne. So I think that is also, it's not a live vaccine. So I think that is also safer. Both of the vaccines are safe. But yes, I agree with you. There are no trials or no studies done on patients who are immunocompromised or who have been in immunosuppressants. What will be the efficacy? What would be, how would they behave? But I think the safety-wise, I don't see any reason. But yes, efficacy-wise, there may be some issue, because these people may be on some sort of immunosuppressant, either some steroids or maybe on, like rheumatoid arthritis or methotrexate, or some people may be on azathioprine. So your vaccine uptake, which a normal person would develop after two doses, say 90 to 95%, these people, we do not know whether it will be 30% or 50%. But as far as safety-wise, I don't see any reason. But yes, the efficacy-wise, in that person, to build up the immune reaction in these people may not be as robust as a normal person, immunocompetent person. So I think that question will be only answered subsequently when we have more trials on these type of patients.
Dr. Shashank, you want to compliment something?
No, I agree with Vasant that people who have autoimmune disorders, they need to take a little caution. But I think the only challenge in these individuals is, or the comorbid conditions, is that the vaccine efficacy may not be as robust. So their ability to build the antibodies may not be that good. So suppose many of these rheumatoid arthritis patients may be on an immunosuppressant drug. So if they're already on an immunosuppressant drug, then their likelihood to make antibody will be less. So compared to others, but should they be not vaccinated? Absolutely, they should be vaccinated. But the point is that if you have an immunological disease, you should discuss with your rheumatologist before taking the vaccine. Fortunately, what is happening now in the first phase, most of these are healthcare workers. So they have access to a doctor, even if it is a nurse or any other paramedical personnel, they have a direct access to the doctor. And in consultation with their doctor, they can take a call on this. So I don't see major challenges with, say, a disease like rheumatoid arthritis. Because remember, a vaccine is always better than a disease. And particularly in a vulnerable group, when there is an underlying medical condition which compromises immunity, God forbid, if you get that disease, obviously the disease is going to hurt you more than the vaccine. And therefore, vaccinating might be a more prudent common sense. But sometimes, some cases, you might need individualization.
Yeah, I think I agree with Shashank that I think it's better to get a vaccine rather than have that disease and then land up in trouble.
So that's true also for hypertension, diabetes, cancer, and all other illnesses?
So yeah, hypertension, diabetes, heart disease, it is very clear cut. Okay, cancer. Okay, I would definitely ask Vasant also to give input. You should talk to your cancer expert. Suppose you are taking cancer chemotherapy drugs or immunological drugs of cancer, which are called as immune checkpoint inhibitors, then you need to decide what time you should get a vaccine and which vaccine to take. So maybe Vasant, you can do this, because this is an area, transplantation as well as cancer, which Vasant sees day in, day out. And that's an area which he has developed a domain expertise. So in these areas, you might need to plan the time of vaccine. So Vasant will probably be in a better position to answer this question.
Yeah, I think Shashank, as far as if it's an emergency, then I think they just go ahead with the vaccination. But yes, what you said is, if given a chance, if the immunosuppressant has to be, say, started after 2 weeks, then possibly vaccinate and then start the immunosuppressive therapy after 2 weeks. But if the person has already taken a chemotherapy and all that, then preferably if the chemotherapy effect is going to wear off in 2 weeks' time, then possibly let the chemotherapy effect wear off and then take the vaccine shot. So then the vaccine efficacy will be much better compared to the person who is on chemotherapy and taking the vaccine. So I would say let the chemotherapy efficacy slightly come down, wait for a week's time, week or two, and then take a vaccine. Then the vaccine efficacy would be much, much better. Or say a person who's on very high dose of steroids, preferably lower the dose of steroid if possible in that patient. So maybe less than 15 milligram or something, which is as good as a natural, because these people will have an adrenal axis completely knocked off. So I think those people to come down to 15 milligram and then take the, if it is possible. It's not that because they have to take a vaccine, they have to lower the dose to control, get the disease. So I think I would say if possible, lower the dose and then take the vaccine. So then the efficacy of the vaccine would be much better. But yes, I agree with Shashank that if the chemotherapy is going on or something, then preferable to wait for a couple of weeks, then take the shot where your efficacy would be much better, or it will be nullified otherwise on chemotherapy patients. But speak to your doctor, very, very important.
You are muted, Dr. Hari Shetty.
Dr. Rohit Suchak asked this question last week, and that's an interesting question. I have taken in Sepsivac. When should I take vaccine? Wait for 1 month, or can take within 1 month of Sepsivac or other vaccines?
So I think as of now, Dr. Harish, there is no data about this Sepsivac. I don't think Sepsivac is it's more of a immunomodulator possibly and not as a vaccine. So I don't have any, there's no data about the Sepsivac and the when to take the vaccine. So I do not know about this, but I think wait for a couple of weeks and then you can take the vaccine. But I'm not much aware about this Sepsivac, but I've heard about a lot of the Sepsivac causing a lot of local scarrings and other issues. Shashank, anything you know about this?
So what happens is many a time Sepsivac is moderate to severe COVID. So if somebody has suffered from severe COVID or moderate COVID, then at least for 1 to 3 months, one should wait and recover from COVID completely and then only give the vaccine. So that is something which is there. So suppose somebody has taken sepsi vaccine 15 days back or 1 month back, I would rather wait for a month and then give them this thing. That also holds true for people who have taken monoclonal antibody treatments like a tocilizumab or itolizumab, or also have taken plasma therapy. So if they have taken all these antibodies, then you should not take the vaccine immediately. Then probably you might have to wait from 4 to 12 weeks before taking it. So these are some of the contraindications which are relatively more careful. And this is something there.
I think I agree with you, especially people who are taking plasma therapy and monoclonal antibodies. The minimum time you would wait is 8 to 12 weeks before. So I think they say approximately wait for 90 days. And especially a person who has already suffered from COVID also, they say preferably wait for 8 to 12 weeks and then take the shot, and not in the immediate infectivity period. So that's what the take is overall.
Thank you. I think this show is only focusing on vaccines. There's a big narrative. There's a big narrative being built that why are doctors made the scapegoats? Why are they guinea pigs? Why not others? So how do you respond to that, Dr. Vasant and Dr. Shashank Joshi?
So I think healthcare workers possibly are at least 6 to 8 times at higher risk of getting COVID compared to the rest of the population. And that may be the reason why they want the healthcare system to be more robust, to healthcare workers to be having their antibodies, so that their risk, which is 6 to 8 times much higher compared to the rest of the population, to be much, much lower down. I think that is a specific reason why, because they are at much higher risk compared to the other world. What's your take, Shashank, on this?
So I agree with you, Vasant. I think the backbone of COVID care, severe and moderate COVID care in hospitals, is the healthcare workers. And they have a high exposure because very high aerosol is generated. So the likelihood of a healthcare worker getting infection, getting moderate to severe infection, and also mortality was very high among doctor community also. So therefore, it's a high risk group of exposure, and which is why probably they have been there. Secondly, if the healthcare workers are vaccinated, then the vaccine hesitancy which is there is unlikely. The third thing is that, you see, if the COVID has a second surge, the strain will first come on the healthcare workers, followed by the COVID frontline warriors. So when you have the front soldiers, they need protection first, apart from the vulnerable groups. So I think that is why, if vaccine was sufficient, all the three groups should have been given it simultaneously. If vaccine was available for everybody, everybody should be given it too. But because there is a finite amount of vaccine being produced, which is why probably they have made this hierarchical preference. And at the front of COVID care are the healthcare workers, followed by COVID frontline workers, which is why that is a priority given to them. Otherwise, there is nothing more than that.
Thank you. Thank you, both of you. The next question is, we saw Boris Johnson taking the vaccine. We saw Donald Trump also taking the vaccine. Why is it that Indian politicians have not done the same in India as it has been done in the more developed countries to provide more faith and moral boosting to the entire population of the country?
Vasant?
I think, Shashank, as I think previously you said, the healthcare system has to be, since it's the main backbone, and you correctly said, I think if you are looking at a second wave, and it should be the healthcare workers who should be having their immune system intact and to handle this, all the patients, then possibly that may be the reason why I think the healthcare system has been looking at as the first lot to be vaccinated, then possibly the rest of the lot. That's what, that is my take. And I think the doctors, looking at the doctors and the healthcare workers taking the shots, I think the rest of the people, okay, I'm not talking about the politician, but the rest of the people would be more courageous to take the vaccine.
I think this, you used a very right word. You said courageous. They would be inspired more by doctors being pricked by the vaccine and selfies of doctors. Dr. Shashank?
I think Vasant is very right. I think the our Honorable Prime Minister made this point very clear. He wants to protect the protectors first. Protect the protectors in... And he had always used a warlike analogy, though psychiatrically you may not agree, Dr. Shetty. And then go to the vulnerable groups. And in the vulnerable groups, most political community will come above 50, most of them. Of course, there will be people below 50 with comorbidities also, but most of them will come above 50. And probably that is when they will take it. I don't think there is a reluctance on their part not to take it. In fact, we have seen politicians within India even enroll into clinical trial programs. So I don't see that as a challenge. I think the prioritization has been based on the degree of the risk of acquiring the infection, availability and the stocks and the geographies. So in that way, a blueprint has been made. 1 crore healthcare workers, 2 crore COVID control warriors, and 27 crores of the vulnerable groups, followed by probably a larger population, which may or may not be needed. We are 130 crore or 131 crore Indians, of which we are vaccinated in 30 crores, presuming that exposure has already occurred to another 30, 35 crores, which would put us at around 60, 65 crores. And then if you immunize another 10, 15 crores, which will move us down to around 75, 80 or 90 crores, we will have some degree of so-called herd immunity. So that probably seems to be at the back of the mind of the government authorities.
Thank you. Mrs. Vinita Bhatia was asking, can we travel after getting the vaccine? I am 65. How soon can we expect to get the vaccine? That is answered. But can she travel after getting the vaccine? Anybody?
So I think it's going to be compulsory that you have to have a vaccine certificate. I'm not sure whether you have to demonstrate your antibodies, but I think a vaccine, 2 doses complete, will be a must if you have to do an international travel. Otherwise, I think you'll be this will prevent you to get quarantined if you're going abroad. So I think that will be must, 2 doses of vaccination, or at least I do not know that what would be the guidelines coming up. But vaccination would be like your card to enter into another country without getting quarantined. So I think that is a way to go ahead, possibly for all of us and all the people across the world.
Thank you. Shashank, you would add something or you're with him?
I would completely agree with Vasant. I think this is going to be a need of the hour. And I think the certificate is going to be there with most people. So if you ask me, when can you fly after you complete your 2 doses? And when does the antibody start coming up? Usually 28 days plus 14 days. So I would put it approximately 45 days. And after 45 days, you will have some degree of an immune status. Remember, 1 dose is not going to be protective. So you will need COVID appropriate behavior. After the 2nd dose, you still will need maybe 2 to 3 weeks. So you are really good to fly after 2 months, if you ask me. If you want to see some efficacy of the vaccine, but even when you're flying, it's only protecting you at 65-70% or 80% at best. And who will have that 80%, 90%, who will have that 60%, we don't know. We are still learning. So in that situation, probably it is still prudent that beyond the vaccine protection, you also do a mask protection, because masking will continue for throughout 2021 and 2022.
Thank you. What happens if people miss the 2nd dose of the vaccine? Vasant and Shashank.
Yes. So I think if you miss the 2nd dose of the vaccine, you should, whenever it is available or whenever it is you accessible to that dose, I think you should just go ahead and take the 2nd dose, because I don't think you should count, okay, I've taken the 1st dose, say 6 weeks or 12 weeks or 20 weeks apart. I think whenever the second dose is accessible to you, please go ahead and take it. Well, that will definitely boost up your immunity, whatever has been getting lowered. So I don't think we should go and say that I'll take the first dose again. And I think whenever available, you count it as the second dose and go ahead and take it. So I think that would be the way, because to go ahead, at least when there is a number of vaccines are much lesser. And I think we'll require more studies or more data on this, that if you skip one dose and say after you come after 6 months, if you remember the second dose, we don't know what is about this. But as of now, whenever accessible, available, you will go and take the second dose after you've taken the first dose earlier.
Shashank, you want to say something? I think you are mute.
Sorry. I think I agree with Vasant completely.
Okay. The next question by Matthew Sebastian. If I took Sinopharm as first dose, then can I take Covishield as second dose?
Yeah. So I think there is a lot of thing in fact, they're saying that if you take, like, for example, I think the Sputnik vaccine, which is of, two human adenoviruses, that one is the adenovirus pi, and second is, I think, adenovirus 26, if I'm not mistaken. So what they saw was that if you're taking both the adenovirus pi at the gap of, say, 4 to 6 or 8 weeks, your immunity built up was much lesser compared to if you're taking adenovirus pi and the subsequent dose of adenovirus 26. So they saw that if you take these two different adenovectors, your immune system or the was more robust compared to the same vector. So your question about, I think, whether you, if you take the first Sinopharm, which is a inactivated killed vaccine, and then you get a Covishield, I think you should go ahead and take it. It will definitely boost your immunity. So it doesn't matter. And in fact, that is possibly the way to go forward, because you may not have access to the same vaccine. So I think as of now, possibly when there's the number of vaccinations compared to the number of people are much lesser, I think the second dose, in fact, there's a lot of saying that the different vector may also have a better efficacy compared to the same vectors.
This is a gentleman who's traveling from Gulf. So this is what he was asking. Shashank, you want to add something?
No, I think, you see, first of all, we don't have clarity. And ideally, we should take the same vaccine as a second dose. Ideally. But as Vasant said, if you don't take it, and both the platforms are similar, but different in their own little way, there is actually a more robust increase in immunity. So that is something which we need to understand. But as I said, currently, all over the world, they have recommended the same second dose. Due to extraordinary circumstances, like somebody is in Dubai, took a vaccine A, comes to India and gets a vaccine B, that's an unusual, exceptional situation. So for people at large, I would like to advise you that try to stick to one vaccine. If your second dose gets delayed, it's okay. Ideally, you should do it in the first 40 days. If you look at standard textbook, the first dose followed by a booster within 40 days. And some cases like Covishield, even when they have extended up to 90 days, they have been able to generate some antibody response. But classic double boosting vaccines, which means you take a vaccine followed by a booster, is 30 or 28 days up to 40 days. That is the classical teaching. Of course, Vasant is a domain expert in this, and he will tell you more details. But I'm very clear about our standards of care, and preferably do not get jumbled up. But if you don't get anything, for example, you have taken one vaccine, you need to boost it up. So then whatever is available, you should take it. That is what Vasant has said. First, try to get the same vaccine. If not, take whatever vaccine is available. It won't hurt. It won't harm. And it definitely may sometimes, in some cases, like he gave the example, may actually boost more.
Thank you, Vasant, for that fantastic clarity. And thank you, Dr. Shashank. What about children under 12 and the vaccine?
So as of now, Dr. Harish, we don't have any data about children below 12 or 12. So far, I think the Moderna vaccine is, I think the Pfizer, they just started at 12, between 12 and 16. So far, it was only above 18. And I think the Moderna vaccine was 16 and above, or it is the other way around. But I think the Pfizer vaccine, the mRNA vaccine, they have just started at 12 and above. So I think only time will tell us anything. Once there are more safety data on about 12 years, then maybe they may go below 12 years. So as of now, we don't have any data above 16 years of age. So whatever is available is between 16 and 18 plus. So they're just, Pfizer just started the vaccination about 12 years. So we wait for that data. And I think I'm sure that why shouldn't it go below for children also? But maybe I think the children, even if they have this COVID virus, they clear it very quickly. And possibly they want to have these trials more in the adult and elderly people and the people who are immunocompromised. And I would say another area is this pregnancy and lactation, those people. So I think that is the area to look forward. Then comes the children.
Shashank,
so I would just make a comment here that children in their first 10 years or 12 years have thymus, which is a vaccine clearing inbuilt. So children are born with the anti-COVID vaccine with an organ called thymus, which involutes after 8, 10 or 12 years. And Vasant, you can correct me if I'm wrong. And which is why most children, 99.95% of children, actually, even if they harbor the COVID virus, they will at best get some mild infection, except very extraordinary rare circumstances, they have got a Kawasaki-like syndrome. Barring that exception, by and large, children have cleared. So children can be spreaders, but children can be shedders. But children are not usually sufferers of moderate to severe COVID. That is usually a rarity, usually an exception, then a rule. And therefore, the priority by the public health system has been given to adult vaccination. Having said that, as the vaccines get evolved, you will have the pediatric trials in place. And as Vasant said, some vaccine manufacturers have started those pediatric trials. And I don't see by 2022 a vaccine which will be eligible for children, say above 6, above 12, or above 18. Currently, most vaccines are eligible for 18. Some of them might have an eligibility between 16, and most of them should be taken after 18. But 16 to 18 and above, below 16, we will have to generate some data and some experimentation in the pediatric category. Currently, the focus is not in that, because as I said, unless there is an exception, most of them are recovering well.
Thank you. I think that's wonderfully said, both of you. I'll repeat this question again, because it's a question which comes again and again. Syed Mohammed El Maksud, what about the transplant patients? Can they take vaccine?
So I think this question is being asked to me by our transplant team at Global. My liver transplant patient in Dubai or liver transplant patient in Mumbai or Hyderabad, they're asking us which would be the safest vaccine. So I think as of now, we don't have data, but if you ask me the inactivated killed vaccine, possibly I would recommend that is Covaxin, possibly would be much safer. But I think Covishield equally would be the vector-borne vaccine also would be safe. But I would say Covaxin, that is inactivated vaccine, would be much safer in the transplant population as of now. But again, we don't have data of either of these vaccines. And I think we don't have even data for possibly even for the mRNA vaccines also. But yes, mRNA vaccines are being used for immunocompromised patients with the patient's consent and with the doctor's consent.
Thank you, Vasant. You want to add something, Shashank?
I agree with Vasant completely.
Okay. Let us ask you again a question which is being asked by everybody. What about pregnancy and vaccine?
So again, we don't have any data about the vector-borne, that is Oxford Covishield, neither the Covaxin. In US, about the mRNA, that is the Moderna and the Pfizer vaccine, they are being given to pregnant women, but with their consent and with the doctor's consent, saying that there is no available data, but fairly, it should be fairly safe. So only with the patient's consent, it is being given in the Western world for this mRNA vaccine. But Indian data for this, we don't have any data for the Covishield, neither for the Covaxin. Shashank, do you have anything new?
No, again, pregnancy, unless it's an exception, then the rule, most pregnant women again recover from it. women in general are protected from COVID. So there is a gender bias and a gender protection. So children are protected, women are protected. Pregnant women also, if they get COVID, usually have had excellent recoveries. Rarity of complications is a rule. And currently data on vaccination in pregnancy is not available. But in times to come, we will have data on pregnancy and lactation. COVID is only 1 year old. Maybe 1 year, 1 month old. So it's only 13 month old disease. Probably usually pregnancy and lactation data takes 3 to 5 years to come. And only after that, we will have clarity on this. It is likely that COVID vaccination might stay. And it's also likely that it may offer protection anywhere from 9 months to 2 to 3 years, sometimes even longer.
Thank you. Three questions left. Is it essential to, again, it's a repeat, but I think this repeat question is very important. Is it essential to take vaccine if I'm following precautions of mask, social distance, and hand washing? Vasant and Shashank.
Yeah, I think without saying, masking will be throughout, I think till 2022 or 2023, 2024. So that will go without saying, but vaccination is a must, I think, because your mask will not give you antibodies. So what is most important to will protect you from COVID-19 is that you have to form your antibodies in the body. And mask will definitely provide, give you protection with whatever way. But I think what is most important is to form the antibodies, and the way to go forward is to get yourself vaccinated as per the government schedule or whatever government authorities, according to whatever they say. So I think you cannot replace, both are important in the way, but vaccination is a way to form antibodies and to completely protect yourself 90 to 95% from COVID-19 disease.
Shashank, you want to say something more?
Completely agree with
you. Okay, the next question is, will the vaccine protect you from other viruses?
So I think this Covishield virus vaccine is specifically designated to the spike protein of the COVID, of the coronavirus. And I think it will protect you only from the coronavirus. It might protect you from other community coronavirus. I'm not sure about it, but I don't think it will protect you from influenza A or influenza B or other viruses. So this is, this vaccine, like even whether the mRNA vaccine, when it's given, it's a genetic material which goes into the cell and stimulates the production of the spike antigen, and then the antigen comes on the cell wall and finally your immunity is there. So it specifically revolves around the spike protein, and it, which is specific for COVID coronavirus. I think that is what best I know about this, all these vaccinations. So it will protect you against only the coronavirus and possibly the COVID-19 virus. Shashank, anything to add on this?
I completely agree. These are COVID-specific vaccines. So unlikely to protect from others.
Thank you.
Other way around might be true. For example, there's data in RBCG, in experimental mode, MMR in experimental mode, that the non-specific immunity of those vaccines could have conferred anti-COVID protection. None of them have stood the test of time in evidence-based medicine.
This is all
anecdotal. This is all in research mode. But COVID vaccines developed currently are COVID specific, at best in the coronavirus family. As Vasant said, they may work. Again, data is unclear. And probably for common cold, whether it will work or not, only time will tell.
Last question of the day, and that is one question which has sparked scientists across the globe, and people are giving different explanations. Why is the recovery rate in India one of the highest in the world? Though we have poor medical infrastructure, hygiene also has been poor across the country as compared to the West, and a lot of negative health indicators, but the recovery rate in India has been above 95%, and that is something which has really foxed a lot of scientists across the globe, and we do not know why. Many reasons are attributed to it. What is your take on this, Vasant?
I think one is definitely to a large extent, some sort of herd immunity has been, because we are thickly populated. If you see Dharavi and all that, yes, they had a big surge for a month's time, but now I think they're almost 70 to 80% herd immunity is there in that. So I think the thickly populated, and that is one reason. And second is, I think also the recovery rate is much faster. If you see, our doctors had the freedom to use remdesivir, to use steroids, when to use tocilizumab, and if I, in fact there was so much being talked against tocilizumab, and if you see the NEJM Journal Watch, which clearly said that even UK, now they are given clearance to usage of tocilizumab to save patients. So I think that liberty of possibly using drugs like using plasma has definitely saved a lot of life of the patient. But yes, partly it was misused also at times. But I would say that liberty of using, I think more or less every doctor had a standard protocol or standard usage of drugs. So I think that helped a lot of patients to be saved. And why it is less severe, I do not know exactly the reason. We were initially talking about tropical country and all, but that did not hold true. But we may be having some sort of inborn immunity to a small extent, but there is no data on this and there's no clarity. So I don't have an answer, but I would say small extent herd immunity, thickly population, and possibly the freedom to use the medication in India will help the patients to get better or recover, and the mortality was lesser in the group.
So I have three hypotheses for this. First hypothesis is we have Naya India, young India, and we have a very small 8% geriatric population. While if you see American population in North America and Europe is geriatric population. So they have senior citizens as a large chunk of the population. And that is why they become in the vulnerable group. And that is why their recovery is slower, because they have multiple comorbidities and their mortality is higher. Well, in India, the disease is seen in a younger population, and Indian population in geriatrics is smaller. That's the first thing. Second hypothesis is the hygiene hypothesis. India is a country which has been vaccinated with BCG. We live and grow with microbes. We have microbes in the air, in the food, in the water which we eat and drink. And therefore, we have developed some degree of gut flora in a symbiotic way, which builds gut immunity as well as innate immunity. And there's a likelihood that we have a better T cell response in general to microbes, which is called as hygiene hypothesis. And therefore, we have lesser autoimmune diseases. If you go to Scandinavia, on the other hand, and the Scandinavian countries like Finland, Denmark, Norway, clearly you can see in those countries that there is a hygiene which is very high and autoimmune diseases are very high. So probably the hygiene hypothesis. Third reason is what Vasant said, that in crowded clusters with poorly ventilated environment, when the disease was at its peak, a lot of asymptomatic exposure occurred. And therefore, places and geographies like Dharavi, like Chittagong, and many urban slums within Mumbai, Pune, Delhi probably have a 70-80% of antibody status with robust T cells. So it is the higher younger population, small geriatric population, possibly poorer hygiene with a BCG vaccinated country. Classic example is Spain, no BCG, Portugal, full BCG. Portugal, less severe COVID, very good recovery rate. Spain, poor recovery rate. And third, as I said, some degree of herd immunity. These are probable possible reasons for a resilient, strong Indian immunity or an immune quotient within an Indian, which probably has led to a faster and a better recovery.
There's a lot of narratives around the BCG vaccine. Iran also had the BCG vaccine, though they started late in the 80s, and they did not have as much recovery as in India. Any thoughts?
This is all hypothetical. This is all in research mode. This is all conjunctural. This may be totally proven wrong. In COVID era, what was true yesterday is not true today. And what is true today may not be true tomorrow. So all documents in COVID are live documents. But we have to look at science, we have to look at evidence, we have to look at clinical common sense and balance it out. Vasant will have the last word, because this is his domain, not mine.
Yeah, I think I agree with you, Shashank, whatever you said. There is some immune protection which is there inbuilt in the Indian community. And I think for that, I think your gut flora is very, very important. I'll give a simple example. If you take a simple antibiotic in US, the US citizens, they land up with C. diff. Whereas India, that people are taking tons of antibiotic left and right, and you know the number of C. diffs are hardly any. So we have some.
Can you explain what exactly C. diff so that the common man understands?
C. diff is a bacterial infection. When all of us have a normal gut flora, we have a normal healthy gut flora. When these antibiotics are taken, your normal healthy gut flora is replaced by the unhealthy gut flora, and that is Clostridium difficile, which happens in the Western world. The moment you take an antibiotic, you will end up with this unhealthy, you know, gut flora. I think our gut flora is very robust, strong, and whatever antibiotics you take, it is resisted by that. And possibly, I think that is one reason what Shashank was trying to do. We have some sort of immunity which is preventing our patients to get into really severe COVID illnesses, or, you know, of course, those people, in fact, there's a study going on why people behaved severely in Wadia Hospital. Dr. Mukesh Desai is doing that. But I think, yes, we have some immune protection within us, which is helping our Indian community to get, you know, reduce the morbidity and mortality in COVID-19.
Well, as we come to the end of this beautiful discourse on vaccines, as the country is going to start with the vaccination campaign on this Saturday, 16th January 2021, we would all welcome maybe everybody to take the vaccine. But last words, appeal to the people of the country from Dr. Vasant and Dr. Shashank. Your last words, which can boost the confidence of doctors and others to take the vaccine as and when they have an opportunity to do it.
I think it's very, very important to vaccinate self, not only to protect yourself, but to protect others. So it's very important. And that's the way you would help your country, your people in India. Get vaccinated whenever your turn comes. Do not shy away from it.
Thank you, Dr. Vasant. Dr. Shashank?
I completely agree with Vasant. It's time to vaccinate. Let's vaccinate ourselves to protect ourselves and protect others around us. And it is time to build the kavach. And I think it's time to stay live with COVID, but with protection.
Thank you, Dr. Vasant Nagvekar and Dr. Shashank Joshi, for this beautiful elucidation. And on behalf of everybody, we would ask each one of us to take the vaccine as and when we will get an opportunity. Thank you all. See you again. Bye-bye.
Bye.